Let us pray. Our Father, we do thank you for our Bible study today. We thank you for the revelation of your truth to us. You tell us in your word that every word is pure. Not only pure, every word is profitable. And we pray, Lord, that this pure, profitable word will do good in every heart tonight in Jesus' name. We pray that you give us attentive hearts and that your word will be plain and clear to everyone. Help us, Lord, to understand. Understand enough to live by your word and then to encourage other people to live by this truth of your word. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. Today we're in Revelation chapter 8. We've been studying the book of Revelation and we've gone through chapters 1 through to 7. I want to remind you that last week we looked at chapter 7 and that was like a parenthesis. That is a period of calm to show God's mercy in the midst of the period of wrath. Before that time, we've seen the seven seal scroll in the hand of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. And that scroll, the book, is still in his hand, is opening the seals one by one. Six of the seals have been broken as the scroll is being unrolled and opened. The seventh seal is about to be broken now so that the rest of the content of the book of the scroll can be opened and read. The opening of the seals has dramatically revealed what will happen on the earth during the Great Tribulation. Just to remind you that the first seal is opened and there is false peace established by the Antichrist. And then when the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, when he opens the second seal, there is war here on earth. And then the opening of the third seal reveals famine, and then the opening of the fourth seal unleashes death, bringing disease, pestilence, and death on the world. And we're told in the scripture that that fourth seal alone, when it is opened, it will claim one quarter of the population of the world, which is about, if it happens now or happens in the immediate future, about 1,500,000,000 people will die just because of the opening of that fourth seal. At the opening of the fifth seal, we see the martyrs under the altar in heaven, praying that God will avenge their blood on those living here on the earth. They are told to wait until the number of the martyrs will be complete. At the opening of the sixth seal, the fury and the indignation and the wrath of God burst on those on earth. Let me just remind you, because that is the immediate connection. You see, the parenthesis we have in chapter 7 is just to tell us that all during that period of the Great Tribulation, as a punishment is coming upon the world, and as the wrath of God is coming upon the unbelievers and the sinners, there will be people that will see the mighty hand of God in all the wrath and the ignition and the fury coming upon the world, and they will repent. And we're told that the Jews that will repent and believe on the Lord, they are called the servants of the Lord. They follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth, and they are virgins because they are pure and righteous and holy. 144,000, 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes of Israel, sealed, secured, safe, because they had been sealed. But then after that, we've seen multitudes of people that no man can number, of all nations and kindreds and tongues and languages. They stood before the throne of God in heaven and they shouted, hallelujah, praise the Lord. They were saying, salvation and glory and honor be unto the Lord, because they have been redeemed and they have been washed white in the blood of the Lamb. But that's just the in between 6 and 7. That is in between the 6th seal and the 7th seal. So the immediate connection actually to what we're reading today, what we're studying today, you'll find in the opening of the 6th seal. And that you'll find in chapter 6, reading from verse 12. And I beheld when he had opened the 6th seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of air, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a
mighty wind, and the heaven departed as a scroll, when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places, and the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains. What were they saying? And why were they hiding themselves? Because now they realize the judgment of God has come, and said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, from and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? It's after that you now have the seven seal, because you remember that scroll was rolled up, and you have learned that when we looked at it in chapter 5, that it was the title deed of the earth, and the content of that scroll, the content of that book, is the thing that will make the Lord Jesus Christ to possess the whole earth, because it belongs to him. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. But there had been a usurper, there had been a deceiver, there had been a liar, there had been somebody that took the kingdom, that took everything by craftiness, by cleverness, and by force. And now it's in his hand. But Jesus Christ is going to recollect everything together, because it belongs to him actually. Actually, you will see that it is at the time when the seventh seal is broken that now you are coming to the very final end. There will be some series of things, events that will take place that will make the Lord to possess the whole earth, because everything belongs to him. Just to give you an overview and to tell you what you are going to see, look at chapter 10 and in verse 7. Chapter 10, verse 7. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as it had been declared to the servant, to his servants the prophets. That is, when you come to the seventh sounding of the angel, the voice of that angel, eventually the mystery of God, the thing that had been hidden, how will God take over the earth? How will he possess the earth again? How will everything that he created now come back to him? It's at that time everything will belong to him. Can you read chapter 11 and verse 15? And the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and it shall reign forever and ever. You see, when you come to the seventh seal, and then you come to the seven trumpets, and eventually you come to the seven bowls and the seven bowls, now you are getting ready for Christ to possess everything that belongs to him again. And so as you come to this chapter 8, and we see the seventh seal being opened and being broken, you know that something climactic and something definite and something mysterious, something that is majestic, is taking place. That's why let me read with you in chapter 8, Revelation chapter 8. I'm reading from verse 1. And when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. And the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of the trees was burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up. And the second angel sounded, and as it were a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood, and the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. And the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp, and it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. waters, and the name of the star is called Wormwood. And a third part of the waters became wormwood, and many men died of the waters, and because they were made bitter. And the fourth angel sounded, and a third part of the sun was smitten, and a third part of the moon, and a third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, 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 to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels which are yet to sound. That's chapter 8. And as you look at this chapter, let me just run through with you and you see the overview. Number 1 is the silent pause, because we're told in verse 1, and when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of an hour. There's a silent pause in heaven, observed in heaven. Number 2, you see a solemn preparation in heaven, because we're told in verse 2, and I saw seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. Those angels, the presence angels, that is, standing in the presence of the Lord, they were prepared. There was a solemn preparation in heaven. And then you have the saints' prayers still in heaven too. Told in verse 3, because it says, another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense which came were the prayers of the saints ascended before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and earthquake. Number four, you'll see severe punishment on earth. After you have that silent pause and a solemn preparation and a saint's prayer, and actually the saints were praying in heaven, oh Lord, when will it be? Will you not visit the earth? And will you not reclaim what you have created, what belongs to you by creation and by redemption? Will you not claim it back? In answer, in response to that prayer, you then have number 4, severe punishment on earth. In verses 6 and 7, and the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. And the first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of the trees was burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up. Number 5, you'll see the sea's pollution still on the earth. The sea's pollution. Excuse me. You look at verse 8. In verse 8, and the second angel sounded, and as it were a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea, and a third part of the sea became blood, and the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. Number 6 is the serious plagues on the earth. Serious plagues on the earth. You look at verse 10, it says, and the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp, and it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. And the name of the star is called Wormwood, and the third part of the waters became wormwood, and many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. Number 7, you see suffering people on the earth. Suffering people on earth, because we're told in verse 12, and a fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe. That means more suffering, more pain, more sorrow. And it says, so the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of all the other voices of the trumpets of the three angels which are yet to sound. And you see that we're reading about the time of the great tribulation, and you find a series of calamities and the series of overwhelming suffering coming upon the people at such a time, because as this seal is opened, you have a series of events, seven in number, represented by the blowing of seven trumpets, there would be a series of overwhelming calamities, more devastating than anything that had ever happened at the opening of the first six seals. In view of these apprehended terrors, the inhabitants of heaven will stand in awe. They will stand still in awe and silence, anticipating the dreaded events about to occur. The series of fearful calamities and thunderings and lightnings and earthquakes, vast terrifying consternation, will be introduced by the blowing of the trumpets. I want you to remember this, that this time we're talking about during the time of this great tribulation, first seal and second and the third and the fourth and the fifth and the sixth and the seventh, the church would have been in heaven from the beginning of Revelation chapter 4. Because you see at the end of chapter 3, you have the closure of the church. That is, you have the message given to the churches. And it's not just the churches of Asia Minor. He that has sealed him here, what the Spirit says unto the churches, is for the whole of the church age. And at the end of chapter 3, the church age is ended. The church is taken to heaven. And then you have the throne of God set in heaven. That's in chapter 4. And then in chapter 5, you have the Lamb of God, the root of David, and the Lion of the tribe of Judah, that stands in the midst of the throne. And he takes the book, the scroll, from the hand of the Almighty, the Ancient of Days, the one that was and is to come. And then in chapter 6, now he begins to open the seals, and we are in heaven already. The church is in heaven already, rejoicing and singing unto the Lord. But then you understand that as all those things are taking place here on earth, the people in this world, they'll suffer a lot. That's why the Bible says, from the lips of Jesus Christ, except those this shall be shortened, there shall no flesh be saved. But because of the elect, because of the Jews, the days shall be shortened. And let's pick up our 3 points as we look at the message today. The message is deadly destruction and devastation on earth. Deadly destruction and devastation on earth. There are 3 points. Number one, solemn preparation and saints' prayer before severe judgment. Solemn preparation and the saints' prayer before severe judgment. Number two, the sinner's punishment and the sea's pollution by the sovereign judge. The judge that is all in all, the judge that has the final say, the judge that is overall, the one, the most high God. There will be the judgment that will come upon the people of the world as the sea is polluted. Then number three, series of plagues upon sinners and upon the unjust. Let's come back to number one. Solemn preparation and saints' prayer before severe judgment. I come back to Revelation chapter 8, and I'm reading to you from verse 1. Revelation chapter 8, verse 1. It says, and when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. I stop there for a moment. You understand that on the opening of the seal, instead of voices and thunderings and tempests, which occurred when the sixth seal was opened, there was an awful stillness and silence. All of heaven waited in reverent anticipation because of the impressive and fearful nature of the events which will then be disclosed upon the earth. That brief period of anxious suspense under the circumstances will seem, will appear very long. It's like, for example, if somebody has gone in for operation and you are staying outside, and then you don't know how the operation is, whether it's successful or not, whether the fellow is still alive or is dead. 30 minutes of waiting will appear very long. Or if there is a calamity taking place somewhere, you have heard that there's an earthquake somewhere and people are buried under the rubbles of the volcano and the mountains moving and everything, and you happen to have a relative there, maybe a wife or a husband or a child in that vicinity, and you're looking, you're waiting for information, and they're making announcement, they're saying this is happening here, this is happening there. All of a sudden, you say, I'm waiting to hear whether my child is still alive, whether my wife is still alive. And you are waiting. If you waited for 30 minutes, it will appear very, very long. That's the situation here. As the angel sounded, and then as the seal, rather, is broken. And then you have that silence in heaven. Because the people did not know the depths and the height and the extent of what was going to happen. Can I remind you, as you come from chapter 4, all through from the chapter 4, it has been the shout of praise and the singing of angels, and the singing of the elders, and of all those representatives of the church, singing unto the Lord and shouting to the Lord. There has been joyful noise in heaven. You come to chapter 5, joyful noise in heaven. And then you come to chapter 6, you have the prayers of the saints, it's still noise, it's still sound. And then you have all those thunders and thunderings and lightnings and voices and everything around the throne of God. All of a sudden, this time, in heaven, there had never been silence like this before, because the shouting is praise, his glory, his worship, and everything. But now silence for about half an hour, because the Lord is about to come now, and is about to bring great judgment upon the people of the land. We're told in Zechariah chapter 2 verse 13. Zechariah chapter 2 verse 13, be silent, all flesh, before the Lord, for he is raised up out of his holy habitation. That's the situation there. The people knew that God now is furious, is angry. The wrath of God is coming upon the world in more measure than it ever came. And because of that, all those creatures in heaven, angels and men and archangels and everyone, they kept silent. And then we're told in verse 2, that's Revelation chapter 8 verse 2. And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. Wait there for a minute. It says, I saw these seven angels, and these were the angels that stood in the presence of God. They stood before God. You know there are innumerable number of angels, and you know there are many, many angels with many levels of responsibility, and many levels of honor, many levels of power. But these are special angels, and there are seven in number. And it says they were standing in the very presence of God. Do you remember an angel like that, that described himself as an angel that stood in the presence of God? Look at Luke chapter 1. In Luke chapter 1, reading from verse 19, you have this angel that occupied this special position, and the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel, that stand in the presence of God, and I'm saying to speak unto thee and to show thee these glad tidings. In the case of Gabriel, it was good news that he brought to Zechariah. But in the case of these seven angels, special angels with special power, with special authority, with special responsibility, they stood in the presence of God, and they were ready, getting ready to unleash the judgment of God upon this earth. Have you noticed something in that Revelation chapter 8 and verse 2? And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. John will not have any problem understanding those trumpets, because he was a Jew. And you might have problem understanding trumpet. What does that signify? What does that mean? Whenever you see trumpets in the Old Testament, in particular, it was to announce something. Yes, they used trumpet in worship, but more than that, it was to summon the people, number one, to worship. Number two, it was to summon them also to war. As we look, for example, in Amos chapter 3. Amos chapter 3, you will understand as it mentions the prophet, and then it tells us the use of that trumpet. Amos chapter 3, I'm reading to you from verse 6. It says in verse 6, shall a trumpet be blown in the city, and the people not be afraid? What's that? When a trumpet is blown in the city, you know, this. When you are called to worship, you are not afraid. But when you are called to war and warfare and battle and struggle, then there is fear. Because you see, the trumpets will summon people, summon troops, inspire troops, muster them for war and for battle and for conflict. That's why it says, shall a trumpet be blown in the city, and the people be not afraid? Shall there be evil in the city, and the Lord has not done it? Wouldn't the Lord know about it? Will that not be part of his plan, part of his program, part of his purpose to bring judgment upon the people of that city, of that land, of that nation on earth because of their sin? In verse 7, it says, surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants the prophets. The lion has roared, who will not fear? The Lord God has spoken, who can but prophesy, publish in the palaces of Ashdod. and in the palaces of the land of Egypt, say, assemble yourselves upon the mountains of Samaria, and behold the great tumults in the midst thereof, and the oppressed in the midst thereof, for they know not to do right, says the Lord, who store up violence and robbery in the palaces. It says, why the trumpet is sounding? It's because war is coming. Why the trumpet is sounding? It's because the God of judgment in his fury and wrath is coming upon the people. That's why the trumpet is sounding. And he's saying the reason why the trumpet is sounding and there's going to be war and battle and conflict and judgment and fury and wrath is because the people do not know how to do right. And they store up violence and robbery even in the palaces. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, an adversary there shall be even round about the land, and he shall bring down thy strength from thee, and thy palaces shall be spoiled. So then you understand, when the trumpet blows, it's talking about calling the people to war. In fact, if you go back to Numbers, in Numbers chapter 10, Numbers chapter 10, reading to you from verse 1 and verse 2, then we'll jump down to verse 9. Numbers chapter 10, verse 1, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, make thee two trumpets of silver, and of a whole piece shalt thou make them. Thou shalt, that thou mayest use them for the calling of the assembly, and for the journeys of the camp. Then in verse 9 it says, and if you go to war in your land against the enemy that oppresses you, then ye shall blow an alarm with the trumpets. When you go to war and you want to call the soldiers to duty and to responsibility and to fight into battle, you will sound the alarm of war. In fact, if you go to Jeremiah, look at this, Jeremiah chapter 4, you will understand as we talk about the presence and the use of these trumpets. It tells us in Jeremiah chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 19, Jeremiah chapter 4, reading from verse 19, my bowels, I am pained at my very heart. My heart maketh a noise in me. I cannot hold my peace because thou hast heard, O my soul, the sound of the trumpet, the alarm of war. You see that? The sound of the trumpet tells them the alarm of war. Destruction upon destruction is cried. For the whole land is spoiled suddenly, and my tent spoiled, and my curtain in a moment. How long shall I see the standard and hear the sound of the trumpet? So then, as you come to Revelation chapter 8, let's come back to Revelation chapter 8, and you see those angels that bore the trumpet, and they were ready, preparing themselves to sound. It meant that God was going to be at war with the people of the world, and with the nations of the kindreds and the tongues, and the people that have refused to repent of their sins, even though they have heard the gospel, even though they've seen other people that are repenting, even though the judgment is coming down in terrible, devastating ways, because they have not repented, that is why the judgment is coming upon them, and God is declaring war upon the earth. The earth, the world of unbelievers, during the great tribulation, while the church is gone. Because you see, the Lord does not have any reason to show them mercy anymore, because they have lived through the time of the period of the age of grace, and the period of the mercy of God, and the period of the love of God, and the period of evangelism, and the period of building the church, and the period of inviting them to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and they have refused, and they have rejected, and they have said, no, we don't need your mercy, we don't need your grace, we don't need your love, we don't need your salvation. And now the time is come that judgment will be poured upon them. That's why you have the trumpet and you have the alarm. I'm reading to you now from Revelation chapter 3, chapter 8, verse 3. It says, and another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, and that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. Let me just remind you that there are two kinds of saints: the raptured saints and the martyred saints. That is, the saints of God, they were ready when Christ came, And then when Christ came, they went up. They are now in heaven. And then the martyred saints, the people that went through the great tribulation, and these saints, they have been crying to the Lord. They are saying, oh God, when? When are you going to judge these people? Look at Revelation chapter 6, reading from verse 9. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And he cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? And white robes were given unto every one of them. And it was said unto them that they should rest yet a while, a little season, until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. And then eventually you have chapter 7. And in chapter 7 you are told, after this I beheld, lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, and they stood before the throne and before the Lamb of God, before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. And you ask, who are these? This numerable number of people. It tells us in verse 14, in chapter 7, verse 14, and I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said unto me, these are they which came out of the great tribulation, and they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Now, all the saints of God, that is the people that went up in the rapture, and those ones that were praying in chapter 6, and the innumerable company of saints, of children of God, that went through the great tribulation, and now they have been killed, they are now in heaven. All of them joined together, and they were praying. And they were praying to God, saying, oh God, it's time now. The number is completed. Because you see that here we are, and we have come from the great tribulation in the world. Innumerable people, they joined their voices together, and they were praying for judgment to come upon the people of the world. What were they praying for? Number one, they were praying that God should judge sin. Number two, they were praying that God should take back the earth from the usurper. Number three, they were praying that God should establish his kingdom over the earth. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. That's what they were praying for. As the prayers of the saints are sent, great fearful calamities descend upon the earth. Look at it in chapter 8 of Revelation. Chapter 8 of Revelation. I'm reading from verse 4. It says, and the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the hand of the angel as it ascended to the presence of God. And verse 5 says, and the angel took the censer, and he filled it with fire of the altar, and he cast it on the earth, and there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. You see, because the prayers of the saints, of course, you know now, there's no sin in their lives. Even when they were in the world here, they were righteous and holy, and they were pure. And now, not only that, they were even now in the very presence of God. If their prayers will be answered when they were on earth, but now when they are in heaven, no sin, no temptation, no molestation of the devil, and nothing at all for them to think about. And they look at the accumulation of the promises and the prophecies of the word of God, that God will take over the earth, and they were praying according to the prophecies and the proclamations and the plan and the purposes of God. And they're saying, God, this is the time. Visit the world with judgment and reclaim the earth again. That's why when the angel took a censer and put their prayers inside, and then like incense, and then put fire, when he cast it on the earth, then you have the answer. You have the voices and the thunderings and the lightnings and the earthquake. And then it says in verse 6, and the seven angels which stood with the seven trumpets got ready now, and they prepare themselves to sound. I come to point number 2, sinners' punishment. Understand this point number 2 and point number 3. They are the responses of God to the prayers of the saints, that the saints had prayed that judgment will come upon the earth. Sinners' punishment and sin's pollution by the sovereign judge. I'm reading to you from Revelation chapter 8, reading from verse 7. And the first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of the trees was burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up. It says, now the seven angels, they began. And it's going to go through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And the first one is now sounding. When it sounded, there was hail and there was fire. Now there are some people, when they read this, they say maybe it means something else or whatever. No, it means exactly what it says. Because you need to understand that these plagues here, they'll be as literal as the plagues that came upon Egypt. Yes, it's a bleak picture. As these plagues of hail and fire bring terrible ecological devastation upon this earth. In the book of Job, God himself has already said it. He said that he is going to reserve the treasures of hail for the day of judgment. Look at it in Job chapter 38, verses 22 and 23. Job chapter 38, we're looking at verses 22 and 23. As thou entered into the treasures of the snow, and as thou seen the treasures of the hail, which I have reserved against the time of trouble, against the day of battle and war. You see now, as the trumpet sounded and then the hail came down, God has said it already as far back as Job, that he had reserved all those things, the hail, for the time of trouble, against the day, against the time of battle and of war. And so it says that when that hail came upon the land, it sawed part of the trees, along with all the green grass, they were burnt up. And then it says, that's a great, great devastation. As you look at that, let me just remind you of what took place in Egypt when a similar thing happened. At that time, it was a limited thing because it was just for the land of Egypt. But now, it's going to be upon the whole earth, and the people of the world are really going to suffer. They are going to cry. Unfortunately, they will not be crying in repentance. They'll be crying in rebellion against the Lord that has power to bring those hails of judgment upon them. In Exodus chapter 9, verse 23. Exodus chapter 9, verse 23. And Moses stretched forth his rod toward heaven. And the Lord sent thunder and hail and the fire. The Lord sent the thunder and the hail and the fire ran along upon the ground. And the Lord rained hail upon the land of Egypt. It was the handiwork of the Lord. It was the judgment of God upon the land of Egypt at that time. What we're studying today in the book of Revelation will be the judgment of God upon this whole earth. It will not just be on Egypt. It will not just be in Africa. It will not just be in America. It will not just be in Europe. It will not just be in Asia. It will be all over the earth. We're told in the case of Egypt, we're told in verse 24, so there was hail and fire mingled with the hail, very grievous, such as there was none like it in all the land of Egypt since it became a nation. And the hail smote throughout all the land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast. And the hail smote every herb of the field and break every tree of the field. And let me show you this in verse 26. Only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, was there no hail? Do you see similarity between this and what you're reading in Revelation? Isn't this the reason why in chapter 7, 144,000 Jews, Israelites, they were sealed? And then we're told at that time when we studied that place that you'll not hurt any tree, you'll not hurt any green thing, you'll not hurt anything on earth until the servants of the Lord are sealed in their forehead for protection and for their safety. So as the hail will be coming down upon the people of the world at that time, all those 144,000 Jews, they'll be preserved, just like it was at the time of the people of Israel in the land of Egypt. You say, how about the Gentiles who had given their lives to the Lord? How about those innumerable people that were here, that they gave their lives to the Lord and they washed their robes white in the blood of the Lamb? You remember, those people are not on earth anymore. They have been killed and their souls are in heaven, because it says they were standing before the throne of God in heaven. They will not be on the earth. The people that will be on the earth, who belong to God, will be the children of Israel, and they will be sealed. And then it says in verse 27 of this Exodus chapter 9, it says, and Pharaoh sent and called for Moses and Aaron, and he said unto them, I have sinned this time, The Lord is righteous, and I and my people are wicked. Entreat the Lord, for it is enough that there be no more mighty thunderings and hail, and I will let you go, and you shall stay, and you shall stay no longer. That means that it's going to be something terrible. Anything that can melt the heart of Pharaoh, anything that will turn him around, that will make him to cry, to say, well, this is enough, it's enough, I will let you go, you know, that thing must be terrible. And the time of the great tribulation, what is going to happen to the people of the world will be so terrible that their heart will not be able to endure. We're looking at Psalm 11. In Psalm 11, I'm reading to you from verses 5 and 6. In Psalm 11, verses 5 and 6, it tells us here, and the Lord tries the righteous, but the wicked, and him that loveth violence, his soul hateth. Upon the wicked, it shall rain snares, fire, and brimstone, and an horrible tempest. They shall be the portion of their cup. That is because the people of the world are wicked. That's the reason why God will be doing this at that time to them. We're told in Psalm 18, reading from verse 12. Psalm 18, verse 12. And the brightness that was before him is thick clouds pass, hailstones and coals of fire. The Lord also thundered in the heavens, and the highest gave his voice, hailstones and coals of fire. Yea, he sent out his arrows and scattered them, and he shot out lightnings and discomfited them. Then the channels of waters were seen, and the fountains of the world were discovered at thy rebuke, O Lord, at the blast of the breath of thy nostrils. So that when the hail is coming down, and when the fire is also following after, and the people are being burnt, and the trees are being burnt, and the green grass is being burnt, you know it is the time of the rebuke of the Lord himself. Isaiah speaks as much about this day of the Lord, that is the period of this great tribulation, the time of the suffering of the children of Israel, as well as the time of the suffering of the world at large. And it tells us in Isaiah chapter 30, reading from verse 13, and the Lord shall cause his glorious voice to be heard, and shall show the lightning down of his arm with the indignation of his anger, and with the flame of a devouring fire, with scattering and tempest and hailstones. For through the voice of the Lord shall the Assyrian be beaten down, which smote with a rod, and in every place where the grounded staff shall pass, which the Lord shall lay upon him, it shall be with timbret, with tabret and harps, and in the battle of his shaking will he fight with it. For Topheth is ordained of old, yea, for the king it is prepared. He has made it deep and large. The pile thereof is fire and much wood. The breath of the Lord, like a stream of brimstone, doth kindle it. You see, he's talking of the time of suffering, the time of judgment, when the judgment of God will come upon the people of this world because of their refusal to follow after the way of the Lord, because of their refusal of the mercy of God. If you refuse mercy, then judgment will come. In Ezekiel chapter 13, reading from verse 10, Ezekiel tells us, he says, it's because they have seduced my people. You say, why is God so angry? And why is God so furious? And why is God pouring out his wrath of hail and judgment without any mixture of mercy at all at that time of the great tribulation? It says it's because they have seduced my people, saying peace, and there was no peace, and one built up a wall, and lo, others doth eat with untempered mortar. Say unto them which dub each with untempered mortar, all these deceivers that deceive my people, that it shall fall. There shall be an overflowing shower, and yea, a great hailstone, and then it says shall fall, and a stormy wind shall rend it. Lo, when the wall is falling, shall it not be said unto you, where is the dubbing wherewith ye have dubbed it? Then it says, therefore, thus says the Lord God, I will even rend it with a stormy wind in my fury. It's a time of judgment, a time of fury, a time of wrath, and there shall be an overflowing shower in mine anger, and great hailstone stones in my fury to consume it. That tells you then, as you are reading about those things in the book of Revelation, the hail and the fire coming upon the people is actually the judgment of God that comes upon the people. Let's turn back to Isaiah. In Isaiah chapter 10, still talking about this time and this period of judgment and fury and wrath that comes upon the people of the world. In Isaiah chapter 10, reading from verse 17. Isaiah 10, reading from verse 17. And the light of Israel shall be for a fire, and his Holy One for a flame, and it shall burn and devour his thorns and his briars in one day, and shall consume the glory of his forest and of his fruitful field, both soul and body. And they shall be as when his standard bearer fainteth, and the rest of the trees of his forest shall be few, that a child may write them. You connect that now with Revelation chapter 8, and you see what the Lord is saying that he's doing. As you read in verse 7, the first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of the trees was burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up. And when that happens, it says in the forest, the trees remaining will be very few, that even a child will be able to count. As we come to verses 8 and 9, look at verse 8 of Revelation chapter 8. And the second angel sounded, and it's as it were a great mountain burning with fire, was cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood, and the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. Again, you see the judgment that continued upon the people of the world. It's telling us these plagues coming upon them as the second angel sounds his trumpet, a great mountain burning with fire. That is, a great mountainous ball of fire will be cast into the sea, and a third part of the sea will become blood. One third of all sea life will die. There will also be destruction of one third of all the ships in the world, that is, on the ocean, on the sea. How about the people inside them? They will perish. They will die. That means that many people will lose their lives in such a violent way, in such a sudden way, in such a way that they'll not be able to have the mercy of God. The extent of these far-reaching judgments and their implication will be staggering and beyond description. As you look at this, see what Hosea says about such a thing. When that thing begins to happen upon the people of this world, that is, the seas are affected, the oceans are affected, the sea life, that is, the whales and the dolphins and all the sea animals, they will be affected. We're told in Hosea chapter 4, reading from verse 1, hear the word of the Lord, ye children of Israel. For the Lord has a controversy with the inhabitants of the land, because there is no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God in the land. You see the reason here why God will be doing what he'll be doing during the time of the great tribulation. Because you're wondering, where is the love of God? And where is the mercy of the Lord? Where is the grace of God? Well, the people have gone beyond the day of grace. The people of the world at that time, of every tongue, of every tribe, they have gone beyond the day of grace. That's why, because it says there's no truth in them, and there's no mercy, and there's no knowledge of God in the land. By swearing and lying and killing and stealing and committing adultery, they break out and blood touches blood. That is, violence comes in such a way that they kill one another and their blood will mix together. Therefore, because of that, because of their violence, because of their stealing, because of their murder, because of their lying, because of their swearing falsely, and because of all the evil they'll be doing, and they will not show mercy to anybody or to one another, therefore shall the land mourn, and everyone that dwelleth therein shall languish, and the beasts of the field and the fowls of heaven, yea, the fishes of the sea also shall be taken away. That is, they will die, they will perish, because of the judgment of God that will come upon the land at that time. I come to point number 3 now, series of plagues upon sinners and the unjust. Series of plagues upon sinners and the unjust. Because as long as those angels keep on sounding the trumpets, then judgments of various categories and various levels and various intensities will be coming upon the people. Remember once again that the trumpet signify the calling to war, the calling to battle. It's a time of conflict and a time of suffering upon the earth. In Revelation chapter 8, verses 10 and 11, and the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamb, and it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters, and the name of the star is called Wormwood. You know, Wormwood, that means gall. That means something very, very bitter. In fact, so bitter it becomes poisonous. And the third part of the waters became Wormwood, and many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. Here we find another judgment that comes upon the people. And it says when this kind of judgment comes upon them, many, many people will die. Now you say, what's the difference? Because this is still water. Yes, there's a difference here. In the earlier part that we read, when it says that something like a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea. That's sea. That's ocean. That's the vast body of waters that you find all over the oceans. But this one is saying the rivers, the waters, from where people get their drinking water. And because of that, that's why drinking it will make them die. That's why it says over here that it's one wood and it is very bitter. And it causes poison, it causes death for them. You see a case like that in the Old Testament. As we look at 2 Kings chapter 2. In 2 Kings chapter 2, you remember after Elijah had been taken up. And then Elisha remained, but he had the power of God. The power that came upon Elijah had come upon Elisha too. Then as he was coming back and the people realized that the power of God was upon Elisha, they came to him and they said, see, the situation of our land, the land is beautiful, but the water is not, and the water is causing us to die. Look at it in 2 Kings chapter 2, reading from verse 19. And the men of the city said unto Elisha, behold, I pray thee, the situation of this city is pleasant as my Lord seeth, but the water is not, and the ground barren. The water, that is the water they were drinking, was making them to die. How do you know that? Verse 21, and he went forth unto the spring of waters and cast salt in there and said, thus saith the Lord, I have healed these waters. Before they were healed, they were bitter. Before the waters were healed, they were causing them to die. There shall not be from thence any more death or barren land. And that's what will happen in the book of Revelation. Please understand, I've been explaining to you over and over. What happened to those people? That's just in a city. That's a locality. That's a community. And people were dying because the water was bitter. Because the water was not drinkable. And there was nothing for them to drink except just that. And they were hoping that it would be all right. And as they drank, they will die. That was just a locality. But now, here we have something massive. Something that is extensive. Something that is taking place in many parts of the world. Because of the judgment coming upon the people. And let's turn back to Jeremiah again. In Jeremiah chapter 9, let's see this kind of judgment coming upon the people at such a time when many of them will be dying because there's nothing for them to drink. If they say that we will not drink because we know it is bitter, then they will die of thirst. And they will say, I'll try my luck and I'm going to drink. I'll see what will happen. They will die of the water. If you don't drink, you die eventually. And if you drink, then you die. You know the situation at that time. The way you can escape that situation is that you give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ while yet you may seek the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he's near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the righteous man his thoughts, because this is the time of the mercy of God, and the Lord will have mercy, will abundantly pardon. But come back to that time, the time when that thing will be happening to them, in Jeremiah chapter 9 verse 13. And the Lord said, because they are forsaking my law, which I set before them, and have not obeyed my voice, neither walked therein, but they have walked after the imagination of their own heart, and after Baalim, which their fathers taught them. Therefore thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will feed them, even this people, with wormwood, and give them the water of gall to drink. The Lord tells us it's because of the sin of the people. It's because of their evil. That is why he'll be giving them that bitter water to drink. He'll make their water bitter, and wormwood will get into that water. They'll not be able to drink and remain alive. We come back to Revelation chapter 8. Revelation chapter 8, the last two verses there. You have verses 12 and 13. Verses 12 and 13, and the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. And I beheld, and I heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe. What's the meaning of this? You see, as the fourth trumpet sounded, then it became dark again. You remember at the time of Moses in the land of Egypt, when there was terrible darkness again, that was just for that nation. And remember, the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were at that time, there was no darkness, there was light, because God protected them, preserved them. The same thing at this time. The 144,000 of the children of Israel, they will be preserved because they have been sealed in their forehead. But at this time now, there'll be terrible, terrible darkness. In fact, we are told, a third part of the sun, dark. A third part of the stars, dark. A third part of the moon, dark. So that the day will not shine for a third part of it. That means that for the 12 hours of the day, there will be 4 hours that'll be totally dark, pitch dark, that people will not be able to see one another. And then the 12 hours of the night, there will be four, that there will be no moonlight at all, nothing at all. It will be terribly dark. When you add four and four together, out of the 24 hours of the whole day, you'll have 8 hours, it will be terribly dark. And the darkness will be felt just like it was in the land of Egypt at that time. But you see, at the land of Egypt, eventually it came light, because in just for a few days, that was for them. But in this time of the great tribulation, what a terrible period is going to be. And now an angel flying through the midst of heaven, and say, you inhabitants of the earth, if you think you have seen anything of those four trumpets that sounded, you've not seen anything yet, because it says, woe, woe, woe. What does that mean? Woe, mourning and sorrow and judgment, when another angel will blow. Then another angel will blow. Then another angel will blow, because now we've seen four angels blowing their trumpet, and out of seven, it still remains three. That's why the angel flying in the midst of heaven said, three remaining, and those three remaining will bring woe and devastation and mourning and suffering and heartache to the people of the world. Now, as we look at all this, you see what will happen at that time. And you see that the only way you can escape is to prepare yourself now, so that at this time of divine wrath and increasing devastating woes upon the earth still to come, you will not be here at that time. I pray you will not be here. The only sure hope and the only sure way of escape for you is to be saved today, and to give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, and to be steadfast in the Lord, and to remain holy. When you are sanctified, he sanctifies your soul, he sanctifies your heart, and he makes you holy, and you remain holy, because it says, follow peace with all men, and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. It says, blessed are the pure in heart, because only they shall see the Lord. Lord, who shall abide in the tabernacle? Who will ascend to your holy hill? They that have clean hands and a pure heart, those who have not lifted up their soul unto vanity. That's why we're calling upon you, if you want to take part in the rapture, so that you'll miss the time of the great tribulation where you'll not be on earth, that the Lord, when he comes for his saints, he will come for you and you will go with us. We're inviting you today to come to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus said in Luke chapter 21, in Luke chapter 21, reading from verse 25, Luke 21, reading from verse 25 and verse 26, Luke 21, verse 25, it tells us, and there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and then upon the earth, distress of nations and perplexity, with perplexity, the sea and the waves running, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, and for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. That's exactly what we're reading about in the book of Revelation. What are you going to do now? If you are born again, you are a child of God already. Now, how are you going to live your life? You are steadfast in the Lord. Temptations will come, you resist. Persecution may come, you resist, and you stand firm in the Lord. In verse 34, take heed to yourselves. Take heed to yourselves, because these are terrible days and these are trying days, and we don't know when the Lord will come. Take heed unto yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness. Let's join the unbelievers in their drinking parties. Let's join the unbelievers in their senseless joy and senseless celebration. That's why he says, you look to yourself so that your heart will not be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of this life. The cares of this life. How many people ought to be here tonight and they are not here? How many people ought to come and study the word of God with us and they are not here? The cares of this life has taken them away, and they will not prepare for eternity. But when the Lord shall come, and the saints of God shall go marching in, and we have all gone, what will be the use of all the money they are trying to amass, all the property they are trying to get? It will be totally useless to them when the deluge of the wrath of God and the fury of God begins to come upon this world, the cares of this life, so that day come upon you unawares. Because as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the old earth. Watch ye therefore. Watch ye therefore. Be very watchful. Are you born again? Watch over that salvation. Are you sanctified? Watch over that sanctification. Are you filled with the Holy Ghost? Watch over that gift of the Spirit in your life. And are you in relationship with the Lord? Watch over that relationship if you are a child of God. Watch ye therefore and pray always. Pray always that ye may be able to, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come, and to stand before the Son of Man. The Lord is telling us that a time of terrible judgment is coming upon this earth, and as that time is coming, where will you be on that day? I pray you'll be on the side of the Lord. And it's very simple. It says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Why don't you make preparation? And not only preparation, make a reservation of a place in heaven for yourself. How do you make that reservation? You repent of your sin. You surrender to the Lord. You say, Lord, I've been long in sin. I am sorry. I will not do all those evil things anymore. I give myself completely unto you. If you give yourself to the Lord, then the Lord will not reject you, will receive you. And then you remain with the Lord. So that when the trumpet shall sound, and Christ will come for his soon, you'll not be found missing on that day. And so I say, remain with the Lord. Don't backslide. Don't allow the little things in this world to make you look away from the Lord. And I pray on that wonderful day, you will be there in Jesus' name. And then when all these things are taking place on the earth, you'll be in heaven looking down, looking at what is taking place on the earth. You'll be on the side of the Lord before the throne of God. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord. I want to be ready when that day shall come. I want to be ready when that day shall come. I do not want to be left behind. I want to be ready when that day shall come. I don't want to be in this place when the great tribulation will be taking place on the earth here. Do you want to be here at that time? Why are you playing with sin? Why are you playing with backsliding? Why don't you give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ? Because this is a time of grace. This is a time of mercy. This is a time of love. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. You can call upon the Lord today, and the Lord will have mercy upon you. The Lord will have mercy upon you if you call upon the Lord. The mercy of the Lord is still available. The mercy of the Lord is still available. But if you reject the mercy of God, then you'll be lost forever. Lost in darkness and sin. Why don't you come home to the Savior today? Why don't you allow Jesus to come into your heart? Have you been rejecting salvation for many years? You have slighted God's calling. You have spurned all the offer that he made to you. His Spirit has warned you so often, and yet from his presence you have strayed. Why don't you come today? Because you are lost without Jesus. Lost without Jesus. You are lost in darkness and you are lost in sin. Why don't you come home to the Savior today? Why not let Jesus come into your heart? The curse of hell is awaiting. And you may be called there today. Do you know? There are people who came last week and they are not here today. There are people that were alive last week. They are no more alive today. Who knows when your time will come? Do not reject Jesus any longer, but come to him. Well, now you may. You are lost. Yes, you are lost without Jesus. Lost in darkness and lost in sin. Why don't you come home to the Savior today? Why not let Jesus come into your heart? If you are backsliding, if you have gone away into sin, if you have gone away into evil, and you know that there's no righteousness anymore in your heart, no holiness anymore in your life, why don't you call upon the Lord and say, Lord, I surrender. I come back home. I come back home. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and he loses his own soul? What will you give in exchange for your soul? Seek the Lord today. Seek the Lord today. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he's near. Let the wicked man forsake his thoughts. Forsake your way. You came here so that you'll be prepared for eternity. The Lord said, watch that will not perish with the unbelievers. Watch that will not perish with the sinners. They'll perish in their sin. They'll perish in their rejection. They'll perish in their rebellion. Watch so that you'll not perish with them. Don't let your hearts be filled with sophistry and drunkenness, so that day comes upon you unprepared, unawares. Because as a snare will it come upon the people of the world, but you prepare to meet the Lord your God. Prepare to meet the Lord your God. The mercy of God is still available today. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I will give you rest. I will give you rest. And learn of me. I'm lowly. I'm meek. And ye shall find rest for your soul. My yoke is easy, and my burden is light. If you are trying to avoid persecution and suffering now, that's why you are not giving your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why you are not taking your stand. That's why you're not making a purpose in your heart. I will stay with the Lord. I will stand with the Lord. No matter the persecution, no matter the suffering. If you are trying to avoid persecution today and avoid suffering today, remember the suffering, the terrible oppression, the terrible attack, the terrible affliction in the time of the great tribulation will be much more intense than anything that may be taking place on the earth today. Call upon the Lord. Don't lose your soul. Don't throw away your soul. And don't join with the devil. Give yourself to the Lord. This is your time of repentance and your time of reconciliation with the Lord, and the blood of Jesus will wash you whiter than snow. The blood of Jesus will wash you whiter than snow. There's an opportunity for you to call upon the Lord today. Why will you perish? Why will you die? Why will you lose your soul? Why will you go to hell? When the mercy of God and the love of God and the grace of God is available today, this is still the age of grace. Why will you die? Why will you die? Why will you die? Why will you die? Why will you be lost? Why will you perish? Why will you go to hell? When the Lord is calling you in mercy, call upon the Lord. Settle the account with the Lord before you go. Settle the account with the Lord before you go, so that you'll not be among the people that will suffer at the time of the great tribulation here in this world, when the saints of God have been raptured up to heaven. Make sure you are saved. Make sure you are sanctified and holy. And make sure you live a life that will make you rapturable.